So we mentioned earlier that there is a question right now on the conversations page. It's what are two components of a diverse arts organization or community? And if you want to share your thoughts, you can go to sphinxcon.org. On the left side of the page, it says conversation page, and that's where you share your thoughts. One response says, the organization has equity as a permanent and integrated component of the entire entity, and it also has a significant number of individuals who are committed to continuous learning and taking action that pushes toward equity. So just one person's thought, we'd love to hear yours. So beyond diversity on the stage, how do you introduce a more diverse selection of composers to the stage? Our next speaker is a faculty member of the music faculty at Morehouse College. He's also director of the Morehouse College Glee Club. He is also a member of the Metropolitan Atlanta Musicians Association and is past president of the National Association of Negro Musicians. Please welcome a SphinxCon founding partner, Dr. David Morrow.
Right undone. Oh, right undone. Oh, I'd undone, what you told me to do. Well, you told me to pray, and I done that too. I'd undone what you told me to do. Well, you told me to sing, and I done that too. I'd undone what you told me to do. Oh, well, I thought I'd do something to get your attention. But that spiritual, I'd undone what you told. Thank you. It is a spiritual that's old, and I did that because our organization is old. The Nationalists, I'm very happy to be here to share with you. And that's really what we're doing, sharing with each other. I can't tell you that what we do is the best practice, but just to share some things that have worked for us. I'm here on behalf of the National Association of Negro Musicians as past president. The current president is Byron Smith, and our executive director is Wayne Woodson, and they were very gracious in allowing me to be here. The National Association of Negro Musicians is a historic organization since 1919. And has been in existence. In 1919, a group of composers and other people came together to try to like-minded about African-American music, excited about African-American music, Negro music at the time. The people who were African-American were Negroes and proud of it at the time. And so we've kept that. And so let's get to it and see some of the things that we've done and hopefully will inspire some things that you might want to do. How do you get diversity from an organization that, by reputation, advocates for African Americans? So one would say that immediately, why are you here? Why would you even come to a conference like that? How are you dealing with diversity? Well, we're talking about repertoire and education, mainly, and that's one of the things that we've been able to do. Show the repertoire of African American composers intermingled in a real way with other composers so that it's not just something that's nostalgic. The mission statement, NAM promotes, preserves, and supports all genres of music created or performed by African Americans. Well, we'd need a billion folks and $1 billion to be able to do that, but that's what we're striving for as we get to be soon 100 years old. It's a 90-year-old lady that sometimes has a little cane, but she's still existing. What we really do best, here are two things that I think we do very well. Promote the spiritual and other African American heritage music. I just did that by just singing with you. If I had the time, I'd have you join in with me and then show you how that would have been created as a piece of music. And advocate for classical African American composers and performers. How do we do it? We have a national branch structure so that there's the national body, but the national body is branches all over the United States. Different ones that do different things. In each branch and in our national structure, there's an adult, collegiate, and youth division. So we're trying to get to everybody so that there's future as well as nurturing of what we have. At our national conventions, We actually, and I'll talk about this a little bit later, at our national conventions, we get to see, like they did at the first one, like-minded musicians. It's always wonderful to see a young person shake hands with Roland Carter, or the networking of some composers that knew about each other but finally see each other. Those are the kinds of things that we are able to do at our national conventions. And then advocacy for different things that are going on. The branch structure is very interesting in that sometimes the national informs the branch and sometimes the branch informs the national, and we kind of go around and around with that. We have branches across the country. Our national convention this year is going to be in Los Angeles. We have about 896 members. We need many more. Hopefully we'll have some more in a few minutes. The national strengths, presence locally, regionally, and nationally. So that's one thing that's very good for us. We have all of those things in place. It allows more impact on youth and collegiate, and we've been focusing on that the last few days under my presidency and a little bit before, so that we can see our organization continue. Possibilities for the national to involve thematic things, so the national body can say, this year we're going to focus on a specific idea. Last year we focused on African-American women in classical music as performers or composers. And so the other branches and regions actually helped promote that all year. There's some challenges. The autonomy of each branch, sometimes we have to remind them, you are part of the national organization, but keep the autonomy of your branch. And of course, that is the where we get our revenue. I talked about the three divisions. We have youth who are participating as singers, as performers, all kinds of things, and the collegiate and or emerging artists. So some of these are in graduate school or they're beginning their way and they want to have a way to at least be seen. And the adult, I put that in quotes, branches. Next. The National Convention, inclusion of African American and Western music in programming at conventions nationally. We do that very much. In a few minutes, I'm going to show you the repertoire of our last national convention where we had two singers and a pianist. And you're going to see the inclusion of the African American music with other kinds of music, and it's so that it's seen in a meaningful way that can be done at any time. This was in July, not just between January 15th and the end of February. Multi-level branch structure requires that we run three different conventions simultaneously. It's really just one convention, but we have a youth convention and they have their schedule. We have the collegiate and they have their schedule, and the upper level where very often we share, and sometimes we cross-pollinate with our clinicians. In this, you probably can't see it too well. I don't know whether you can, but you'll see Chopin, and then you'll also see Undine Moore on the program. This was our gala presentation that we had last time. You'll also see Rachmaninoff, and you'll see Moses Hogan and Joseph Joubert. So that our idea is that the repertoire is just repertoire that should be performed at any time and at any place in a classical program. This is one of our youth choirs. Heard that spiritual before. Next is one of our students who was the third place winner in our scholarship contest. of time. So at those conventions, we get to nurture those students as well. The interesting thing about the spiritual and the choir that was done, that choir rehearsed a few days and performed. And the conductor was also the arranger of that spiritual. So he had heard it, he made the arrangement, and with these young ladies and young men that he meets for the first time at the convention, creates this. A little bit about advocacy. Dr. Louise Toppin in Vidamus includes, and she is one of our board members and is the head of voice at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, did a wonderful inclusion of African American music in programs of majority white students. She did a program of African American music with mostly white students performing them and getting feedback from some of the composers who were there. At our convention, we had Robert Sims do a masterclass on singing spirituals. So not just performing it, but he had them perform the spiritual and then give them some ideas on how it's going to be sung. What are some things that this particular arranger was looking for? What are some things that you might hear in a spiritual? The New York branches, we have three branches in New York, in the New York area. And they're meeting with their city council members and school board members to discuss the lack of arts programs as well as inclusion of African American music in music education programming. That's the first time that they've come together as a unit. So sometimes there's some strength in numbers in when you actually say something to someone or make your mark. So not necessarily a mob mentality, but just some strength there. Dr. Barbara Wright Pryor is a columnist, a singer, and she was on the planning committee for the Chicago Symphony to do Florence Price's Mississippi River. Before that time, which was in the last year, I believe, they had not done a Florence Price piece for 87 years. And so getting on these planning committees, if you get to get on them, make your mark, say something about the different kinds of music that are there, and we can then use those ways to advocate for the music. No one can come to Detroit and not mention Dr. Brazil Denard, who is a past president of the National Association of Negro Musicians and a conductor, and his wonderful classical roots collaboration with the Detroit Symphony is legendary. People have used that model all over the United States, so we're very proud to call him one of our past presidents. Our scholarship contest, we've been doing a scholarship contest for a long time. Our first recipient was the 22-year-old Marian Anderson. The inclusion of pipe organ as a competition category is very important because in terms of the literature and in terms of the instrument itself, that is not one that many African Americans are using as much or performing on as much, and so we encourage that as part of our competition. Repertoire diversity. All of our contests include European and American repertoire as well as African American composers, so that we have that. In the arts, in the voice category, we have an interesting situation in that we have the African American art song. These are art songs by African American composers and arrangements of spirituals as part of the competition category. And then there's opportunities for the winner so that we can show this music again, other than just in nostalgic circumstances. They will be presented, we sometimes have those persons, winners or runners-up, presented in concerts all over the United States. And this year's winner is going to be at the Color of Music Festival, a new festival in Charleston. This is just an example so that you can see how we're trying to do that. The alto saxophone category, you have many wonderful composers there, but the contestant must select also from T.J. Anderson, William Grant Still, Andrew White, Frederick Tillis, and Anthony Green in order to compete and win in the competition. We also, as a result, show these wonderful pieces of music that people may not even know about. The same thing for mallet percussion. This year's competition is winds and mallet percussion. For the first 50 years of the competition, it was about piano and voice. But later on, we begin to use other the categories. This is a concern that we have and that was raised by Roland Carter, past president. He says, my concern is that African American music cannot exist in a vacuum unless we broaden the base of membership so that we may educate our white brothers and sisters. We will be forever working to preserve what is lost. Of course, there is that educational piece for many of our own, especially the youngsters who have limited exposure to and desire for the art music of our heritage traditions and composers. So we always have that as a concern, being able to make sure that people are aware, being able to make sure that when there is the need for or the desire for African-American performers, that they are ready and we're able to say who they are. Making sure that our young people have an idea that, yes, we can do that music too, and that that music is not just something that is done on Black History Month, but can be done at any time. And so with that, I am done, and I appreciate your attention.
Just a quick follow-up question. In terms of the young people, mm-hmm. what's their reaction when they find out that they're performing the music of an African-American musician?
They are often pleasantly surprised. One, because there is no guarantee that just because it's by an African-American that it, quote-unquote, sounds African-American. There's some music by some African-American composers that is on par and sounds like any other music. And so it's good to know that these composers exist, and they then are often questioning, why haven't we heard this before? And so that's part of what we're happy to be able to do. We'll go over there and meet him, because he's Adolphus Halestork is right across the room. He is often at our conventions. You know, so things like that happen, and they become very excited. And then excited about creating on their own, because they say, well, I can do it.
Have you found that it's a way to help young people, both African-American young people and other young people, reimagine the African-American experience?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, we are always competing with popular culture. Nothing wrong with that. I think it's a good challenge. But with classical music, there's always creating that interest and using. I have one student who is very decidedly using the whole notion of shout music in church mm-hmm. in some piano compositions that he's writing mm-hmm. that he is going to make a suite of pieces on. So there's always that inspiration and that ability to fuse all of their experiences together.
Wonderful. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome back to the stage the founder and president of the Sphinx Organization, Aaron Dworkin.
Good morning, everybody. Oh, hang in there. We're almost to lunch. It's coming soon. People in the music world, and especially the orchestral field, have a difficult time talking about the audition process for orchestras. So I thought it would be a great topic to talk about at SphinxCon. Why the orchestra audition process must evolve. Orchestras do not call themselves, or name themselves after, Mahler, the Beethoven Orchestra, the Tchaikovsky Orchestra, the Shostakovich Symphony Orchestra. Instead, orchestras name themselves after the communities in which they reside. Some of the majors, New York Philharmonic, Chicago Symphony Orchestra, Boston Symphony, Cleveland Orchestra, Philadelphia, San Francisco, Los Angeles, Philharmonic. And as I think about that, it occurs to me that since they do name themselves after their communities, a significant aspect of their mission and who they are and what they do should relate not only to the music they perform, but the communities in which they reside. And if that is the case, when we look at American orchestras, is literally a blind snapshot the best way that we can select the newest member of an orchestra. And for those of you who don't know, basically orchestras will put up screens. And so people audition behind a screen, they'll often have carpets so you can't hear shoes, because they wanted to have a process that had a greater sense initially of equity. They wanted to get rid of nepotism, and this has transformed gender representation in orchestras. But these changes were made decades ago, and the question is today this type of process the best way to select a new member of an orchestra? I wanted to share with you a couple of quotes from leaders in the field who are not focused on diversity whatsoever. Success today is not limited to the quality of execution. The things that represent quality today are much more varied, more democratic, more inclusive. Orchestras have to be more innovative, experimental, and creative. This is Jesse Rosen, the president of the League of American Orchestras. And again, for me, the most powerful part of this is the very first sentence. Success today is not limited to the quality of execution. The general level of playing has never been higher. With a heightened technical level and versatility has come a certain loss of character, style, and individual point of view among orchestras. This was Tom Morris, who, if you will, is kind of the curator of American orchestras, runs Spring for Music at Carnegie Hall, which he selects the orchestras who get to come to Carnegie Hall and perform, was a longtime president of the Cleveland Orchestra and headed up the Boston Symphony. Though no one would like to admit it, interchangeability, again at the highest of levels, is in danger of becoming the norm. This is Jim Astrag, the well-known arts critic at the New York Times. And so, for me, there is this similarity between these statements. One, that there's a high level of performance going on. There's no doubt about that. But that the issues facing orchestras relate to this homogeneity that now seems to exist among the greatest orchestras that our nation has to offer. And if that is the case, and if they reside in communities that are named after themselves, communities that are, of course, by definition of our nation, very diverse, then to me it seems that the lack of inclusion that exists in orchestras plays a role, is not the sole arbiter, but plays a role in this challenge of homogeneity that exists, and that clearly many of the leading voices in our field who have no specific interest in diversity feel must be addressed if our orchestral field can move forward and can thrive. And we know that inclusion plays a role because the numbers are so stark. Only 2% of orchestras are Black or Latino, respectively. We also know that when you build a diverse environment, and this comes from a recent Rockefeller Foundation-funded study, that diverse workplaces help American businesses/organizations become more innovative and competitive. So if we want our orchestras to be more competitive, we want them to be more innovative, more creative, they have to have more diverse workplaces. And their workplaces are incredibly, having a significant lack of diversity, a lack of inclusion. So we have a lot of work to do. So if we know that we do want to build this inclusion in orchestras, then really the question becomes, can orchestras even become more inclusive with the current hiring approach? Because the only way the workplace is going to become more diverse is if we change the process of how we're hiring people. Now, I could talk about orchestras in all kinds of forms, their board, staff, because all of these areas need help. But specifically for this session, I'm talking about the artistic membership on stage. So as we look at the hiring process that orchestras do, if we want to look at how we want to change something, the first thing we have to do is understand what's happening right now. So I'm going to give you just a little bit of background on orchestra hiring and the statistics, because that helps us to drive to some type of conclusions that could be of some use. So when we look at American orchestras, there's about 6,000 full-time orchestra positions, because a lot of orchestras are part-time. So if we look at those who are earning full-time salaries, this tends to be about 40 weeks or so plus per year. It's about 6,000 positions. Now, orchestras are very static. People stay for a very long time. There's only about 200 positions that actually become available on any given year. And for those 200 positions, every single year, there are over 40,000 applicants. And these are conservative numbers. Every single year, coming from our collegiate system, from music schools, we have 11,000 undergraduates and 4,000 graduate students. And of those, in terms of percentages, about 12% of our undergraduate music graduates are Black and Latino combined, and about 8% of our master's students, so about 1,300 and 300 respectively. So this helps us, again, to try and reach a few conclusions, which means that there's an average about 200 openings if you want a full-time position with a position with a full-time orchestra, where that's your main source of revenue and personal income. There's an average of over 200 applicants per position, and there's many positions that have 300, 400, even 500 applicants, which means that our acceptance rate in orchestras is 0.5%, or as we like to say, for those of you outside the field, winning. We like to win an audition. You won your position with the Cleveland Orchestra or the Detroit Symphony. Which, of course, when I'm talking to people outside the field, they find that very odd. You know, I won the position as chief physician in the emergency room. I won my position to work at the law firm. But it's how we term things in the orchestra field. To give you a sense of perspective, in our Ivy League system, the average Ivy League college acceptance rate is 9%, or 18 times higher. So what that tells me is that we're elite. And as a musician, I like that. I like to be elite. The point I'm trying to make is that if that's the only thing that we focus on, we shouldn't be so bothered when people consider us to be elitist. If we continue on with some of our conclusions, based on these statistics, if we assume that Blacks and Latinos receive the same level of training as their white or Asian counterparts, then 0.05% is the acceptance rate for Blacks and Latinos at an orchestra audition. Obviously, because they're a smaller part of the pool. And these statistics I'll share with you are important because, yes, you can play better, and I'm about to talk about that when you get yourself in a certain level of playing. And that can increase your odds, just like applying for an Ivy League college. But you cannot escape the overall statistics. And if we are looking at policy that we are trying to develop in our field, we have to understand the reality that these numbers exist. So I want to paint a little illustration for you. If Sphinx were to develop a partnership with seven orchestras, let's say seven of these kind of major orchestras that I mentioned before, and with every one of these orchestras, we placed five fellows. There's kind of a fellowship program process that you can do. A fellow gets to sit with the orchestra, play with the orchestra regularly, so they get that experience. They get mock auditions, they get training, they get individual coachings with members of the orchestra. So this would be a very, very robust program. So what I want to do is imagine that Sphinx could develop this with seven of our major orchestras, place five fellows who played full-time with those orchestras, which in many cases would quintuple the Black or Latino representation in those orchestras. And I should add that, unfortunately, both from Sphinx's perspective or these orchestras' perspectives, nobody thinks this is actually realistic. No one thinks we could do this next year. Sphinx doesn't have the funding, and the orchestras couldn't just, you know, automatically place five Black and Latino fellows in their orchestras. But if we imagine that we could, and then our curriculum for this program was so successful that we trained every single participant to be in the top 5% of their performance ability, and then Sphinx funded them to go out and to take an orchestral audition every single month for the entire year, which would result in 420 auditions every single year. It would take us 3 years before we placed the first fellow in an orchestra. One person. And from a policy perspective, at least from Sphinx's perspective, our goal is to build representative diversity in terms of at least the overall population. The overall population is about 30% Black and Latino. If we did that, and if we had this successful program running every year, it would take us 600 years to reach nationally representative diversity in full-time orchestras. In other words, of the 6,000 positions, if we had 30% that were filled by Blacks and Latinos. And if we actually look at the cities in which most of these orchestras are based, minorities, Blacks and Latinos, either already are the majority or will be soon. And so if our goal was to actually be what we refer to as city representative, it would take us 1,000 years to reach that point, or half of human history since the birth of Christ. My point is not to be flippant about these numbers, but to articulate how difficult the situation is, and that merely advocacy programs that help in a small way to build a pool, and we're already doing a fair amount of this work, can only go so far. We have to develop systemic changes, some of which may be incredibly difficult, if we're actually going to change this scenario in our field and build more diverse workplaces. So I would suggest that we consider some evolved criteria, and these evolved criteria will require orchestra boards, staff, and musicians to rethink how we have traditionally approached our audition process. Going back to some of those original quotes, one of the very first things that I would suggest is that in our audition process and our selection process, we ask for more than just the notes. It's very clear from their quotes that what they're saying is the notes are there. There's something else missing. And we certainly aren't asking for it in our audition process. I think there's ways that we can, outside of directly the full-time positions on stage, look at other artistic staff that can be part of orchestras, faculty, substitute players, chamber groups. For example, the Cleveland Orchestra has a chamber group from the membership of the orchestra. They go out, they play in bars, these types of things. They engage the community. If orchestras and what they do is more than just their standard subscription concerts, then these types of aspects could engage additional artistic staffing for orchestras. We need to address the diversity that's on the podium. This is a program that Sphinx is currently in the process of developing and having conversations with various orchestras that would kind of be a maestro academy, partnering with orchestras and music schools as well to specifically address the diversity on the podium. But in the end, we have to evolve the audition process itself. And I would suggest that we do that from what I refer to as a blind snapshot, literally, to an open-eyed, comprehensive criteria that we establish and set forth for the audition process. And because I like acronyms, and because it's just easier to remember and a little more fun, I refer to it as actors. First, artistic excellence. It goes without saying, and as a musician, if I looked at the process for orchestras and anything else came out of my mouth other than artistic excellence to begin with, I would wonder what on earth all of my training was about. It is critically important that we have artistic excellence as the primary criteria when we look at membership in our orchestras. It goes without saying. What all of those three quotes were that I started with mention is that the artistic excellence was there. And trust me, if the artistic excellence isn't there, it's the very first thing that we hear about as an orchestra, as a musician. But second, collaborative ability. I believe it's important to know how a musician can collaborate with others. Obviously with the music director, so they can actually follow direction and there can be a unified sound for the orchestra, but also how can they collaborate with other members of the orchestra? How else are chamber groups going to form? And various things and activities that the orchestra will do that can't necessarily be planned by its management. Teaching skills. Every major orchestra has major educational programs underway. So what are the pedagogical skill sets that this person is potentially bringing into our institution that can advance our educational programming? Originality and creativity, potentially one of the most important criteria that I believe is lacking. Orchestras as a whole, the perspective from people outside our field is that the last thing they think is that orchestras are innovative or creative or risk-taking. We need to bring the skill sets that embody that into our institutions. And it can't just be one person working in administration. It needs to be amongst the membership of the orchestra themselves. And there are ways to adjudicate this in a selection process to identify the originality and the creativity capabilities of the candidates we're considering for our orchestra. R, repertoire knowledge, a very, very key point. Less than 1% of all of the works performed by America's orchestras are by any composer of color. This is not, I don't believe, on purpose that orchestras are out there saying, we don't want to play music by composers of color. It's because they don't know. The knowledge is not inherent within the institution to make the appropriate artistic decisions. And it can't just be an artistic administrator who somehow is informed. This information can come from the membership of the orchestra itself. And it needs to, otherwise that 1% number is also only going to change incrementally and probably be 600 years before we get to a point where even 20% of the works are, that are performed by America's orchestras or by any composer of color. And with all of these criteria, of course, there is the strategic cultural relevance. And I refer to it as that as opposed to an H for hire blacks and Latinos. Because that's silly and it doesn't do anything for our art form or for our communities. But strategic cultural relevance as a criteria, one criteria of a number, is important. It's important to any business on this planet. If there's a corporation, say Coca-Cola in Detroit, and they know that 90% of the community in which they reside and which their company is named after is African American, and they know that 3% of their customer base is African American and 1% of their workforce is African American, there will be a strategic cultural relevance criteria that that Detroit Coca-Cola company will be focused on until they fix the relevance issue for the mission of their company or their organization. And I suggest that orchestras need to look at that and, based on their community and based on their mission, assess the strategic cultural relevance of a candidate, provided that they meet all the standards of artistic excellence, that they can bring collaborative ability into their institution, that they have teaching skills that can lend support to their educational programming, that they have originality and creativity that will provide an innovative environment for the orchestra, and that they will have the repertoire knowledge to build on the library of music and art that the orchestra can share with its audiences and communities. Chimamanda Adichie, the famed Nigerian author, said, "The danger of a single story is not that it is untrue, but that it is incomplete." And I would just like to leave you sharing that my concern for orchestras is not that they are untrue to the music, but that they are incomplete reflections of our art form and of the communities in which they reside. And for that reason, we must evolve the audition process that currently exists. Thank you very much.
So I want to start, I guess, at the beginning a little. This is a very defined set of expectations that you have, or hopes that you have now. Have your expectations and your approach to this work changed since you first started Sphinx?
My expectations of the field?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, they significantly adjusted. I knew that the orchestra field would be slower than I would necessarily like in terms of its pace towards change. But I was surprised by the extent to which that is true. And kind of what I mentioned earlier yesterday, the lack of even voice to the issue, let alone actions. There is such an entrenched fear that it seems to me that we have. Just talking about the audition process, screens, people feel that if you raise a question about, for example, the existence of screens in our audition process, that's terrible. And the immediate thing that it does is it erases artistic merit and the credibility of a process. And that doesn't have to be the case. It could be the case if you did it in a way that wasn't thoughtful and And you just teared down the screens and said, you know, we just want 30% of our orchestra to be black or Latino, so let's just make that a priority. But that's not the way that real change occurs. The way real change occurs is that you challenge the assumptions that you've made potentially for decades, in our case, and you say, this is how we've done it, but is there potentially a better way now? Do we know more now than we did before? And are there things that we can do that aren't necessarily one extreme or the other, but are a clear step in a direction that will deliver results, that will actually change the issue that we're trying to solve? And I'm continually surprised by the lack of progress and steps. Because one thing that I do know is that, like many fields, our orchestral field will follow things that are successful. Everybody loves success and will follow success. It's only going to take a handful of orchestras, less than a handful, I believe. And there will be a couple, and they will make these changes, and they will be the leaders, and there will be a couple that will fail, and that will be tough for them, but there will be a couple who will be successful, and everyone will follow them.
So in terms of how you approach this work, how have you had to change as you've come to this realization that things are moving even more slowly than you expected?
Well, the first is patience. We're patient and persistent. So that's first and foremost. Second is that we respect the reasons for the fear and the reasons for the delay and the inaction. It's not just arbitrary. There's fundamental substantive reasons why people feel this way or institutions end up acting in this way. And then third, we have to share and provide viable, at least starting points. So I'm sure any orchestras hearing my presentation aren't going to agree with every criteria. I doubt any orchestra on the planet will actually implement actors as I've laid it out. But if there are components of it that can serve as the starting point so that any orchestra at least does evolve its audition process in some way, shape, or form that brings about a difference in the results of their workplace diversity, which will affect the innovation and the creativity of that institution and ultimately make it a better orchestra for its community and for its art form, then we'll have been successful.
Do you find that you're still having to make the case for diversity and equity, or have you sort of bridged that hurdle and now it's just finances or what?
Great question. For the most part in the field, I never hear from professionals in the field, we don't need to be more inclusive. So usually it's, we'd love to, but we can't. We'd love to, but we can't. And then usually my next question is, what have you tried? And then there's usually crickets. So there are those on the fringe, and for example, when I shared yesterday some of the messaging from outside of our field and people who have a certain agenda, we do get some of that, but that's a rarity. I don't think really professionals in the field feel that way. So it really is making the case. So we feel that responsibility is on us to raise the issue and to provide potential solutions, obviously the focus of the convening, and that some of those solutions may be contrarian. I can only imagine over the course of these 3 days, we'll hear things that are in some ways contradictions. And that's the whole point. There's not a unified solution to this issue. And the answer for the Tulsa Symphony is going to be different than it is for the Albuquerque Symphony or the New York Philharmonic. And so what we want to do is provide a palette of opportunities, but we mostly want to make sure that institutions begin to act on them. And I would say that today, our biggest focus is on the absence of action.
Do you find that the success of Sphinx in some way can work against you and that people can point and say, look, there's an orchestra, it's diverse, they're all African American Latino, all of these young kids are getting access to lessons and music, what's the big deal?
Hopefully they're not kind of saying that.
But you get my point.
Yes, yeah. Absolutely. So an interesting thing, and I'll kind of use the Sphinx Symphony as the example. Number one, of course, in our direct educational programming, where we're, in other words, we're in schools or with teachers, you know, day in and day out with young people, that's in the hundreds, right? And the young people we reach overall with our programming and concerts is in the thousands. There are millions of students that, of course, that Sphinx will never, ever, ever reach. And so our big issue is how do we take the things that we are doing and having some success with, but making sure that they come to scale in the field. That's really what matters when it comes to developing policy. Can you take good ideas, not only test them and make sure whether they work, but then bring them to scale? So that's key. And one of the things from the outset of Sphinx, and at certain points we've had the opportunity to have, for example, the Sphinx Symphony that you all hear tomorrow in concert, be a permanent orchestra. But that was never the intent. It goes directly against what our mission is. We don't want a permanent Black and Latino symphony. We want America's orchestral landscape to be inclusive. We don't want to have a separate list, like I mentioned yesterday. We want there to be one inclusive list. Our art form benefits from diversity. It benefits from a diverse palette of interpretations of music. I was having a conversation, sorry to go on about this, but I was having a conversation yesterday about the Kreutzer Sonata, Beethoven's Kreutzer Sonata, that, you know, is one of these great pieces in the violin repertoire. And of course, many, many people don't know that it was actually written for George Polgreen Bridgetower, a Black British violin virtuoso who premiered it with Beethoven in 1803 in Vienna, and for whom he wrote the work. And there are aspects of the work that you can hear that relate to the person that it was actually written for. And even though it's known as the Kreutzer Sonata, and Kreutzer never performed it in public, as a musician, knowing that information can be of benefit as an interpretive musician. And so literally by having diverse voices, diverse information and knowledge will change the way certain repertoire is performed. That elevates our art form. An orchestra that is more along the lines, if there was an orchestra that for 10 years used, say, this actor's criteria, that orchestra, I guarantee you, will perform different repertoire, will perform in different places, and will perform the repertoire differently than orchestras do now. And I believe that's a benefit, not just a benefit, but is a necessity to our art form that elevates. When you look at the trajectory of any art form, it goes through phases, and those phases are fueled by new voices, new interpretations, diversity, innovation. That is what enables us to evolve art forms and to also preserve and I think to truly capture the history and the legacy that exists, even great works like the Kreutzer Violin Sonata.
You mentioned the work Sphinx does in classrooms and schools with young people. Do you think the loss of arts education in the school systems, that's actually slowed this process down, or are these really two separate issues?
It's all connected, which is why we all have to act and engage, from schools to music schools to youth orchestras, professional orchestras, colleges, conservatories. We all have to act together in this process. But it's been devastating, the cuts in arts and music education. And just as one example that I often comment here in Detroit, Motown couldn't happen again today because there was a massive pool of young talent coming out of the Detroit public school system that had been trained and had access and the ability. It's not just exposure to music at a young age. It's the opportunity to study and develop the craft. Art is not just picking up an instrument and saying, I'd like to make music. There's a craft behind it that has to be studied and architect and developed. That's what really leads to all of the youth development benefits of our young people as it relates to the arts. And because that has been, you know, almost wiped out, there isn't that huge pool that there used to be. And that's just Detroit. And this is replicated in cities across the country. So it's been devastating what's happened to music education. But with that said, that's not the only place to focus. And it doesn't excuse. And I often hear from either orchestras. Well, you know, music schools, we'd love to, but you know, they don't come show up at our auditions, et cetera, so music schools really need to do it. Music schools say, well, you know, it's the school systems, we don't have the feeder, these kinds of things, and no one seems to have responsibility. Mm-hmm. And even school systems say, well, we'd love to, but communities don't rise up, and the reality is the easiest thing to cut is the arts. No one's gonna come and like pick it outside of my door or, you know, throw me out of office if we cut the arts, but they do if, you know, if we cut other things. Mm-hmm. And so everyone seems to lack the area of responsibility. And we believe that people need to act at every level. And there is something that can be done at every single level. There's no excuse for delay.
My final question. As you look forward and you look at the progress you've made so far, what gives you hope? Where have you seen signs of progress and movement?
Well, I think what gives me hope and drive, and just that we'll never stop doing what we're doing, is our any of the young people, and seeing them and the looks in their faces and their parents or audience members, and that's what, when you see how music transforms people's lives, there's just, I mean, you get up and you have to do it. You have to. And so I think that initially just kind of overall. But I do sense an uptick in the dialogue so far in our field, and in music and in theater and in dance, and some of the cross conversations that are taking place, and an uptick in the initiatives that we've at least seen that we weren't the initiator of, which is what we really love to see. So there were certain groups that formed last year at last year's SphinxCon to further this conversation and to carry out new initiatives. And other organizations that started other programs separate from anything that Sphinx was working on. And so I sense an uptick in that. More I've sensed an uptick in the dialogue and not yet the action. But that is at least a sense of hope. But every little step matters, and there are, our field is filled with people who feel passionately and who do want to see this change. And I think a huge swath of people have felt like they either don't have the answer or they need someone to join with them to make a difference even in their own institution. I see that, and so I believe that there's a tipping point, like a Malcolm Gladwell tipping point, and we will hit that. I'm absolutely confident of that.
Ladies and gentlemen, Aaron Dworkin.
Great, thank you.
So here is where we break for lunch. If you look in your program, there is a list of restaurants both here in the Renaissance Center and in the downtown Midtown area. So go stretch your legs, have a bite to eat, talk amongst yourselves, and we'll rejoin each other here at 2:00 this afternoon. Thanks.